for accepting our invitation. A very brief introduction. We have already lost a little bit of time about our speaker today. Dr. Roman Kumar has got a PhD in from the Center of Wildlife Studies in Bangalore and is an MSc in Forestry from Dehradun. And he is currently the Director of National Science Initiative, and he's got a lot of experience working on the ecological research in the Western Himalayas. His area of interest, to keep it very short and brief, he'll fill you in later when he talks, is the vulnerable Grady Slaty Woodpecker in the sub-Himalayan forest. And today he is going to familiarize us with the woodpeckers of the Sal forest of Uttarakhand. Raman Kumar Saab, over to you without any delay. Srikant, you have to switch over to the speaker now, please. I'm switching off.
Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot, and it's a pleasure be part of this very interesting series of webinars. And I thank Deccan Bird. It's still BSAB in my mind. It's very difficult to, you know, mentally shift. I thank you all for inviting me. And over the next half an hour to 40 minutes, I'll try and share my experience, whatever little there is, on the woodpeckers of the Western Himalayas, particularly the Sal forests. And I'll touch briefly on the aspects of my study and what I learned. So this was during my PhD work. And I will try and keep it as non-technical as possible. At any point, if you feel there's a need to, you know, stop me and ask or clarify, please, you're welcome to do that. And please note down your questions, and hopefully we'll take them towards the end. Yes. Thanks again. So if Mr. Srikant gives me a green signal, we can begin?
Yes, sir, we can go ahead.
Good evening again, everyone. And I am currently sitting, you know, at the base of the Himalayas in Dehradun, Uttarakhand. And my work was also in the surrounding forests where I live. And today, maybe some of you are already familiar with the area. You may have visited, maybe on a birding trip or a personal trip or whatever. But nonetheless, I'll there seems to be a slight lag, so please bear with me. This is because of the technical limitations of my internet connection. So if you don't mind, to preserve bandwidth, if you allow me to switch off my video.
Yes, please.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so as you can see from this illustration, it gives you a sample of the kind of diversity of woodpeckers that we have in the Sal forests of Uttarakhand. Okay, I have been fascinated by woodpeckers, even before I got into birding. And I shared this interesting experience with a few others as well. So when I was in school, at the back of a class on the notice board, there used to be this chart pasted introducing us to birds. And my first introduction to the woodpecker was this bird. Yeah. And I found it really interesting and fascinating, this bird. And moreover, I used to often see it even on our school lawns or even at a home in our garden, trying to, you know, peck, you know, on the ground. So I always wanted to see it actually peck wood, but I waited and waited and it never happened. So this bird remained my favorite, and I knew it as a woodpecker until at the bright, you know, young age of 24 years, I went birding with a couple of friends. Actually, that was my first birding trip. And I got into a kind of an argument because I saw this bird and immediately alerted the others saying it's a woodpecker. So a friend corrected me, and it was quite deflating at that moment because I was so confident that this is a woodpecker. Anyway, so my friend showed me a real woodpecker, and I mean, initially I was a bit disappointed because of this, you know, it's like, you know, the bird that you've been revering as a woodpecker, it was a bit disappointing to discover that it wasn't a woodpecker at all. However, on the positive side, I actually liked this bird even more, and I was even more fascinated by it and its, you know, behavior and its vertical posture, for one. I mean, it was almost like human, you know, vertically standing, vertically looking at me eye to eye. And of course, it was a beautiful bird and had a very striking appearance. So let me just fast forward. I mean, I'll skip the part how I, you know, started getting more interested in birds and eventually started working, doing my research on birds. However, I continue to work on birds, and however, this woodpeckers were always at the back of my mind. And as I got deeper into research, out of just curiosity, I started reading about them. Now, when I started reading about woodpeckers, and I naturally assumed that there would be a lot of work, studies on the ecology of woodpeckers in India or even in the subcontinent. But it was quite surprising that, although we had a lot of natural history work, notes, JB Nature's and so on, there wasn't a serious study on the ecology of woodpeckers. And if you can appreciate this graph, so this is based on a review paper. I'm sorry if some of you find it a bit technical, but I'm sure you'll appreciate the importance of this graph. The blank bars, they actually show the number of research papers published. This is split by continent. And the dark gray bars are showing the number of woodpecker species present on that continent. Now, if you just look at the North American figures, so we see that, there are less than 25 species of woodpecker in whole of North America, but there's a humongous amount of research on those species. Now this, I'm talking about this review paper, which was published in 2006. However, things haven't changed too much. So this may as well reflect the present scenario of research. Now, in contrast, just take a look at the Asia bars. So funnily, there are fewer studies on woodpeckers done in Asia than there are species. So it tells you you know, how little this group has been studied. And if you talk about India, the only study a serious ecological study that I came across was done by Dr. V. Shantaram, who's currently at Rishi Valley. And he was quite helpful and he guided me a lot initially and helped me pursue this idea of studying woodpeckers further. Now, before continuing on my work, the audience, I would like to briefly share the uniqueness of woodpeckers. Now, woodpeckers have evolved a chisel-like beak, and it's really powerful and sharp and very efficient tool. And it helps the woodpecker to make excavations on really hard surfaces, like tree trunks and heartwood, and, you know, which most other birds and animals cannot utilize. The other interesting modification of a woodpecker is, and I'm sure some of you may have noticed it in field on your birding trips, is that if you ask a child to draw a typical bird foot, they will draw three toes forward and one backward. Although it's true that most birds have this design of feet, but in woodpeckers it is modified with two toes in front and two behind, which enable them to have nice grip and better traction on vertical surfaces. Now, the other thing which of course is not very obvious is the fact that a lot of woodpeckers, most of them actually, have really long tongues. It's a bit difficult to see it in field because, you know, they are always probing crevices and all. But as shown in this picture, the tongue of the woodpecker is used very effectively to probe, crevices and galleries made by borers and grubs and larvae to gain access to them, and that is actually their primary diet. One thing which all of you may have, would have noticed in field is how woodpeckers, when they climb up trees, they use their tail to prop their bodies up. So the tail is also a modification, and it is quite stiff. It's made of very stiff feathers, which provide extra support to the woodpecker in this unusual, posture which it uses to gain access to food and forage. Ecologically, woodpeckers are extremely important. Studies have shown that because they are primarily insectivorous, experiments have shown that areas where woodpeckers were removed, they experienced almost 40% increase in insect abundance. So they certainly have a big role in keeping a balance on the insect populations in nature. Perhaps the most important ecological role of woodpeckers, and which also makes them really important, so much so that they are known as keystone groups. So their main role is, and the ability is creating cavities. Now, as most of you may be aware, that woodpeckers not only use cavities for nesting, they also use cavities for nesting, roosting, which means around the year, woodpeckers will have a series of cavities, both for nesting and roosting. Now, since we were talking of roosting, it's not as if a woodpecker has a single roost cavity. So often they have a cluster of roosts, so that if you know they sense danger in one roost, they utilize the other one as a backup. It also mix and match. They never use the same roost predictably to ward off possible predators. So you can imagine in a woodpecker's lifetime how many cavities it would be constructing. Now, woodpeckers are among the very few vertebrates which can actually have this capability of constructing tree cavities. Of course, barbets also do, and to some extent nuthatches. Kingfishers also, but they don't use cavities in wood. They use earth cavities, and of course bee eaters are also similar to kingfishers. So this provides refuge both as a resting place as well as for nesting to a huge variety of other birds and animals. To name a few, this includes mynas, hornbills. So hornbills actually often use woodpecker-made cavities, and they repurpose it. And so do parakeets. And also reptiles like lizards and snakes, and even bats use woodpecker cavities. So if woodpeckers are removed from a system, then the cavity production mechanism gets seriously affected, and it goes into lockdown, if I may say so. And I came across this cartoon by a friend, Rohan Chakravarti. I'm sure you are familiar with him, where he's visualizing woodpecker cavities as real estate. And it's absolutely true. The sheer variety and volume of other organisms these woodpecker cavities support in nature. Let's look at the world perspective. So woodpeckers are fairly widely distributed. They occur almost everywhere, except parts of Oceania, which is Australia, and they don't occur in Madagascar. Other than that, wherever there are forests, you will find woodpeckers. Now, if you're able to see this map, so the richest, the most diverse regions in terms of woodpeckers are the darkest one, the one with the darkest shade of red. And immediately you can probably appreciate that there's a patch in Amazonia, and of course Southeast Asia is a nice rich patch. However, what is not obvious is the Western Himalayas, because it's too small to appear on that map. So we'll come to this a bit later. So these are the this is the distribution, and it also gives you an idea about the global hotspots of woodpecker diversity. So as I was mentioning earlier, woodpeckers are very closely related to forests. And this picture here is probably one of the most talked about woodpecker, particularly in recent times. So the ivory-billed woodpecker. I suggest if you are not aware of the story behind this. So this woodpecker was presumed extinct until it was supposedly rediscovered about 15 years ago. Again, there was a big controversy and, you know, it was a very contentious issue. But anyway, so the point being that woodpeckers have been, are associated closely with forests, which means that any changes that we make in our forests, in particular the woody vegetation, is likely to have an impact on the woodpeckers living in that ecosystem. And since I had a background in forestry, I was naturally interested in how forest management operations affect biodiversity conservation values. So then, it began, and then I started thinking about this as an idea. So more of that slightly later. And so globally, there are about over 200 species, of which just over 32 are found in India. And here's a nice illustration by Rohan Chakravarti again, which gives you a glimpse of the really diverse assemblage of woodpeckers of our country. Now, so this map again shows the woodpecker rich areas. So just to put it in perspective, the darker the green, the richer that area is in woodpeckers. So again, looking at this map, you may appreciate that, and immediately there are three areas which pop up. Western Ghats, to some extent, Orissa, parts of Orissa, the northeast part of India, and of course, the Western Himalayas. And just for your information, so this part, which is circled, which is the Uttarakhand sal forest, it supports 17, at least 17 woodpecker species. And this is how sal forests look. They are really high canopy. And they occur, gregariously. That means there are huge swathes of sal forests extending right along the sub-Himalayan region, all through to Northeast India. So, and this is another picture which gives you an idea of the sal forest. And the sal forest canopy is often really high, with trees easily, 25 to 30 meters high. Since the colonial era, the sal forests were economically very important. And that is because when the railway network was being established in the subcontinent, there was a huge requirement for railway sleepers, and it was found that the wood of this sal tree was ideal to be used as railway sleepers. So because of this economic demand, there was a lot of stress on obtaining economically viable produce from sal forests, and that resulted in a very intense focus on sal forests in terms of forest management operations. And this sal forest region is extremely diverse. It's better known for the tiger, the elephant, and the more charismatic species. However, it's extremely rich in woodpeckers as well, as I was telling you, 17 species. And here is the complete illustration that I showed you earlier. This shows about a dozen different species of woodpeckers. As you can see, they range, a broad spectrum of size. The smallest one, of course, is the speckled picklet right at the center of the illustration, which is about 10 centimeters. And then at the other end is this, on the top, the great slaty woodpecker, which is an unusual woodpecker. And it's huge. So it's, 40 to 50 centimeters in length. And arguably it is, some people think that this is the largest surviving woodpecker in the world, considering the great the ivory-billed is extinct, and of course the imperial woodpecker, which was already extinct in the Americas. And a few pictures, and I'm afraid I'm not much of a photographer, but here are a few documentary shots. This is the speckled picklet, our smallest woodpecker. The gray-headed woodpecker, also known as the black-naped green. And this is the Himalayan flameback or Himalayan goldenback. So this one is also known as the Himalayan three-toed woodpecker. So instead of four toes, it has three. Lesser yellow-nape, you may be familiar with this bird. Rufus, and of course the largest, the great slaty woodpecker. It'll never make it to National Geographic, but it tells a very interesting story. So I'm not sure if you are able to make out that there are three woodpeckers in a single frame. Now the interesting part is that all three are different species. So this is just to underscore the variety, the richness of woodpeckers in the region, and the fact that they coexist. If you happen to take a walk in the sal forests, particularly in winter, I won't be surprised if you see up to 8 species of woodpecker in a single, mixed flock. So, but that's in winter. So it's not unusual for them to associate in mixed flock, particularly with other birds as well. Maybe about 2 dozen other species of bird. I hope you appreciate the importance of this picture. And by the way, this is a sal tree. And I would ask you to pause and observe the nature of the bark of the tree, the deep, crevices and fissures, and the peeling bark. So all this translates to a lot of resource. There's a lot of insects, hide under these crevices and bark, the peeling bark. So this is a good forage for all kinds of woodpecker. Now, the main questions which I started to ask was, since I was interested in forest management and the impacts, so because woodpeckers are extremely closely tied to woody vegetation, so I wanted to check how are woodpeckers affected by historical management of SAL. Secondly, what are the factors which contribute to their richness and abundance? And another very interesting ecological question. I mean, how do they manage to coexist without, you know, interfering or competing with each other? Because so many species are found virtually together. So I looked at four different kinds of forests, and you may appreciate that these are supposedly good forests, all of them. However, what is good for, in our perspective, may or may not be good for the woodpeckers. So these are four categories of forests, and I'll just skip through that. So I spent a couple of years collecting information. There were occupational hazards. Although I really enjoyed bumping into elephants and tigers, but that meant I could not collect the woodpecker data. The other challenge was that because the habitat was so dense, I had to, you know, practice a lot of identification by calls to ID them. So I'll quickly share one or two results from this. So this graph, I'm sorry if some of you find it slightly technical, but just look at the red boxes. So you can make out that you know, the natural SAL, which is the undisturbed or unmanaged part, they house much higher woodpecker density, almost 50% higher than the next best category, which is the managed SAL. And on the other hand, teak plantations are really poor in terms of resources for woodpeckers or as habitat. Now, this was in the non-breeding season, but look at the same graph for the breeding season. And I'll just flip through that so that you can make out what is happening. So during the breeding season, the density of woodpeckers in natural SAL increases a lot, which is accompanied parallelly by a decrease in density in the managed categories, which means that during the breeding season, a lot of woodpeckers from the managed forests move to the natural forests, perhaps because these contain better nesting resources. So that was one of the interesting findings of my study. The other finding was that although, I mean, the forests look very good, but I urge you to, so this shows the different species of woodpecker arranged by size from bottom to top. And the color indicates a different species and their relative abundance. So in natural forests, if you just look at the outlined red part, which shows you the four largest woodpecker species. So in natural forests, they constitute more than half of the woodpecker community. But in managed forests, they are reduced a lot in number, and they are virtually absent in teak plantations. So the take-home message is that although forests appear to be good, managed forests appear to be good, but they seriously affect particularly the larger woodpeckers, and they are not as suitable as natural forests for them. On the other hand, if you look at this purple woodpecker, which is the black-rump flameback or the lesser goldenback, which is a generalist species, so the relative abundance increases, in managed forests. Now, the question was, how do woodpeckers manage to coexist? And if you can appreciate this, so this shows the preferred diameter of tree by each species, and even a lay person can appreciate this trend, which is increasing, which means the larger woodpeckers prefer the thicker trees, and this is how they are able to segregate their resources and coexist. So yeah, and just to briefly summarize, I have already stated these things, and we'll be happy to have questions if there is time, and if there are questions. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, Ramendra. That was quite informative on the forests and the woodpeckers. I mean, I think it's a favorite species for many people over here. So thank you very much. So guys, we will be open for questions. I mean, you can type in the chat your questions, and we can start asking him. So there is, hello, Raman, so can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, yeah.
So I'm trying to enable my chat.
Yes. So we have one question from Mr. Raja Jaipal. How old are the teak plantations? Probably does the age factor account to the population of the species?
I'm sorry. Are you able to hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, I'm my screen. Oh, now I can hear the. There seems to be a lag. Sorry. I'm sorry. Can I ask you to repeat what you were saying?
Yeah, Mr. Raja Jaipal was asking, how old are the teak plantations? Probably an extension would be. I mean, does the age of the tree matter? Yeah. For?
So the teak plantations which I surveyed were about as old as the youngest sal trees, which means they were set up around the 1960s.
Okay.
So about 50 to 60 years old.
Okay. So a question from Satwik. A generic question related to woodpeckers is that only during breeding season, woodpecker make burrows or nesting?
So what's the question here?
Is that only during the breeding season?
Yeah, so it's
make burrows or nesting. Yeah.
They make cavities only during the breeding season. And cavity making is a very energy intensive exercise. So I have actually seen woodpeckers, they try and reuse their older cavities if there are available. And as far as roosting is concerned, so the roosting cavities are not very, deep, because they often are, just, they go inside the tree and not downwards.
Okay.
But, woodpeckers, because they have to roost and they have to have multiple roosts. So they end up making several cavities, you know, per capita cavities made by woodpeckers is pretty high in a year.
Okay. So there's another question from Divya. Out of the 17, is there any species endemic to the region? Or I would rather put it more than the region, just to the salt forest as well. I mean, an extension to that question would be mine.
No, there's... I don't think there's any endemic species. It's okay. Limited to only salt forest.
Okay. And what about the region? Region of your study. Was there any endemic species?
Yeah. Yeah, same.
So we have lost you, actually.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, you can hear
me. Yeah, please. Next question.
So... I'm just trying to. What is the only species of 17 in the French? Okay. Well. I think some years back, one question from Vishal. Some years back, there was a problem of sal borer in Karwa Pani area near Dehradun. Was one of the reasons a decline in woodpecker population? Was this one of the reasons for decline in woodpecker population?
Actually, no one studied it in terms of woodpecker, but anecdotally, it was the other way around. The woodpeckers actually benefited from the borer infestation because they had a lot of, you know, resources and the food resources increased.
Yes. So, a question from Ms. Devika Rani is, Mr. Raman, Dandeli take monoculture supports a few species. Question is, do all hornbill nest in woodpecker nests created by woodpeckers? So, do the all the hornbills, they do all the species of hornbills, they nest in woodpecker nests?
No. Hornbills would nest in any cavity, even natural cavities, but woodpeckers' cavities are, you know, better suited for hornbills in many ways because natural cavities have their own inconsistencies and, you know, they may not be suitable. So they require a lot of, repurposing compared to woodpecker-made cavities. And that's how I see it.
Yes. So... just moderating a few questions here, sir. So,
yes, please.
Yeah. Is there any forest fire affecting woodpeckers? Yes, definitely it would be affecting most of the species.
It actually depends on what kind of forest fire there is.
Yes.
If it's ground fire, then obviously it does affect. Although, burnt forest trees are often attacked by other insects and all, which again benefit woodpeckers indirectly. But during the time of fire, of course, it's not a suitable place for woodpeckers.
Yes. And JVD sir asking a question, what is the number of great slaty woodpeckers today, given the destruction of their habitat, naturally or otherwise?
We don't have exact numbers, but as far as the trend, the global trend is concerned, they are, and just to, just for your information, this great slaty woodpeckers, they extend all the way to, through Southeast Asia to Borneo. And since these areas, there's a lot of clearing of forests. So the habitat of the great slaty is estimated to have reduced by 90%, which because of which it is now red listed. However, in India, it's fairly stable. We don't have exact numbers, unfortunately.
So we don't have the exact numbers, yeah, unfortunately. So one question from Sudhir Murthy is, which parts of Uttarakhand can you find larger populations of Great Slaty Woodpecker?
So the Great Slaty is very closely tied to the sal forest, particularly where the larger trees are, which means the older forests. So Corbett, parts of Rajaji National Park, and the intervening region in between them. Although there have been reports of Great Slaties in managed forests, along the banks of the Yamuna as well. But yes. The mainstay, I guess, is Corbett Rajaji landscape. And of course, across the state, then there is Dudhwa in Uttar Pradesh. And then all across, even in Nepal and then right through to Arunachal.
Oh, okay. Thank you. So the next question, from Satvik again, is, so do we have any migratory species of woodpeckers in India? And do they migrate during
the season? Except, if you consider the wryneck as a woodpecker, which belongs to the woodpecker family. The wryneck is the only migratory, truly migratory species. Of course, all woodpeckers show a bit of local movement, but most of them are resident. All of them are resident, except for the wryneck.
Wrynecks, yes. So, one question is from Maitreya. Are Great Slaty Woodpeckers cooperative breeders?
Yes, they are. They are extremely noisy. They hang out in large groups and sometimes, more than half a dozen individuals. And they are behaviorally more like babblers. And they, similar, just like babblers, they are cooperative breeders. So the previous year's chicks, which are now grown, they help rear the current year's brood. It has been, and I have also observed this.
That's an interesting observation, sir. And I think one more question we have here is, in hide culture, people are feeding, or won't such hides affect the food searching behavior of the birds, including woodpeckers?
Of course. That's without question.
Undoubtedly. Yes.
They modify any provisioning or, any behavioral modification. For example, call playbacks. So it messes up with the natural
first thing.
Biology.
So one question by Ms. Parnima Mohite. Is the natural sal forest composed of only the sal trees, or there are other species of trees as well?
So sal forest is sal dominated. It's not as if it's 100% sal. But one would say maybe it's 80% sal. So there are other trees also, terminalia and, jamun.
Jamun tree, yes.
And several other associates. But sal is dominant.
And Ashish sir has a question. Could cooperative breeding be a response to lack of nesting places or growth forest?
It's difficult to say, but I think it was. It's
or old growth. I'm sorry, nesting places are old growth.
Such kind of traits are, they evolve over much longer, periods than the limitations of nesting. So one theory suggests that the great slaties primarily feed on ants, and they actually go scouting for super abundant supplies of ants, basically ants nests, and once they locate it, then they cooperatively feed on that. So maybe living in a group itself was an evolutionary strategy which led to cooperative breeding.
Okay. So I think no further questions. We have 2 more minutes. Anyone would like to ask? Okay. Sir, I have one question. I mean, which is the best season to sight a great shady woodpecker?
Actually, they are quite vocal before the start of the breeding season, and even in winter they are quite vocal, and in winter they hang out in fairly large groups. I've seen great slaties in groups of about 11 or 12 individuals. Okay. So and practically winter is a better season because you can do your birding the whole day.
Yes.
Summer is a bit constraining, and they suddenly go quiet when they start excavation. So okay. Then it's pretty difficult for people to spot, detect them.
Okay. So one question from Bunny. What do you think the reason behind more woodpeckers live in sal trees? What are the good properties of sal trees that make it a very good habitat?
So these great slaty woodpecker, as I told you, is distributed all through Southeast Asia and Borneo. So it's basically a tropical forest bird. Uh-huh. And sal is the tropical genus species.
Correct.
So it has evolved along with dipterocarp forests, as they are known, and sal is a dipterocarp.
Okay.
And what properties of wood? The bark structure, mm-hmm. and I was mentioning earlier, the fact that a lot of insects live on the uneven bark surface of sal trees. It provides them forage. And of course, nesting sites also, because they are nice and vertical, and woodpeckers can build nests high up. Probably that it could be one of the other reasons.
Okay. So woodpeckers are distributed globally. Are they found only in sal forests in other countries also?
No, of course not. What I meant was they are forest specialists. So most of the European woodpeckers are, you don't have sal forests in Europe. But.
Okay. Just a second, please. Other than man-made disturbances, what are the threats woodpeckers have? I think this is a question by Divya.
Yeah, so there's one indication that even in managed forests, there's this practice of removing dead trees. So that may be one of the critical factors. It's basically habitat and availability of nesting sites which determines woodpecker survival.
Yeah, okay. Sir, I think one of the participants wants to ask, which is your favorite woodpecker and what unique feature you like about that the most?
I think my favorite would be the Rufous Woodpecker. And I like it because it's pretty unusual among woodpeckers, both in terms of appearance and also behaviorally. And some of you may know that the Rufous Woodpecker, it actually nests along with these carton ants.
Yes. So
this is a very interesting story. About that, I urge you to read it, and there are some very nice videos also.
Yes, yes, sure. Yes, sir. I'm sorry. Yeah, what are the other tree species that are suitable for woodpeckers in foreign countries? What are the other species of that are suitable in foreign countries? I mean, tree species suitable.
I mean, it's. I mean, there are woodpeckers everywhere. There are forests, so.
Yeah. So, no trees, no special tree bunny. Yes. Yeah, but yes, sir. We are done taking questions here, I guess. So, thank you very much, Raman sir.
Thank you, and.
Thank you very much for the talk, and it's been actually quite interesting session for us.
Yeah, and. If any of you have any questions or, I have, please, Mr. Srikant will share my email address.
Yes.
So you're welcome to contact me at any point.
Yes. And thank you very much, sir. And thanks to all the participants who have joined us today. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Raman Kumar, for the talk. It was really fascinating. Your graphs and your studies were really.
कुछ नहीं मेरे को याद पूरे दिन भर मतलब कल रात को मैं तेरे को फोन करने वाला था लेकिन.
Javeri sir, we are unable to hear you.
I just wanted to thank Dr. Raman Kumar for the lovely talk and the illustrative data that he has provided. That's a lot of research that has gone into it. Yes. And I think there should be more research done on this. Is there anybody working on woodpeckers, especially in India and abroad?
Apart from Raman Kumar, sir, nobody I know.
I don't think so, right? But thank you, sir. Thank you. And thanks a lot for the very nice talk. I enjoyed myself thoroughly.
Pleasure is mine, and thank you so much, and all the best to all of you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. But
at any point you want to visit Uttarakhand when things are slightly better, please feel free to contact me.
That'll be great. That'll be great. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for the offer. Thanks for the invitation.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Thanks, Srikant.
Thank you, Javeri sir. Thank you very much. Bye, everyone.
Srikant.
Thank you, all the participants, for joining us today.